And now we are going to talk about cultural citizenship in a non-digital way, because how can art museums help adult second language learners to acquire a language? How can such initiatives constitute a framework for cultural citizenship for new citizens in Danish society? Please welcome Nanna Bernhardt and Lise Sattrup from Statens Museum for Kunst in Copenhagen.
Thank you. Thank you and good morning. Wow, it's a really big room standing up here. My name is Nanna Bernhardt. I'm head of school programs at the National Gallery of Denmark, or the SMK. And we want to thank you for inviting us here today to do a presentation. And I'm here with my colleague, Lise Sattrup.
Yeah, I'm Lise Sattrup. I'm a PhD fellow at the National Gallery and at Roskilde University. And we will raise the big question again about the democratic role of art institutions. And as we talked about yesterday, art institutions today are measured and are forced to prove their relevance and their democratic role, and often by numbers of visitors. Instead of following this market logic, we will try to open up a new perspective, not raising the question about the democratic role from another position. So we are not talking about whether the audiences come back to our institutions or not, but we are talking about what the audience engagement enable at the moment where they are in the institutions. So we will present two cases as point of departure for the workshop later on today. And the two cases are not digital, but those cases are part of a larger project called Museums and Cultural Institutions as Spaces for Citizenship. It's a larger project which took place in Copenhagen for some years in 10 larger museums and cultural institutions. But before we will present the cases, I'll quickly go into the notions of citizenship. And the reason why we do this is because we hope it will be a helpful tool for you in the workshop to examine your own practice. So when we go into citizenship, there's of course a lot of different understandings of this notion. And the most common and the most used notion today is the disciplinary citizenship. But that's based on an idea of democracy as a stable order, where citizenship is to discipline the individual to fit into this order. And then citizenship is a status you can gain, and it's about socializing and qualifying the individual for this order. But then on the other hand, you also have cultural citizenship. And in this notion, citizenship is understood as a process, a learning process, and it's about transformative learning process, new ways of being, new ways of becoming, and it's a mutual learning process. So it will change the democracy itself, and it will change the individual. And we will try to have these two kind of notions as the background for our presentation. I hope you can use it for your discussions later on.
Yes, and I will present the first case, which is about adult language learners or language schools at the SMK or the National Gallery. And I will first start by just give a very short introduction to the National Gallery. Here it is. The National Gallery of Denmark is a very classical Western National Gallery. We are covering 700 years of Western art history. You can see the very monumental building here, very classical. And of course, this museum is kind of born out of the Enlightenment project of the 19th century. And also in this period, the same period where the idea of something being specific Danish or Danish identity was constructed. And of course, this is also very much part of the whole kind of history of the museum being a national gallery. So what I will do today is to present a project we've been working on for the last year in collaboration with the Thorvaldsens Museum, also in Copenhagen, and in collaboration with the Copenhagen Language School. And it's a project where we have developed a new educational program for language, adult language learners. But I will also try to look into or try to show how this kind of project actually is a project influenced by these two different notions of cultural citizenship, because on the one hand, we have made a project where the objective is actually also to learn Danish. It's also about acquiring skills. It's about acquiring qualifications on your way to maybe someday gaining Danish citizenship. And on the other hand, it's a project influenced by the whole idea of cultural citizenship, of new becomings, of new narratives, using the art museum as a space for this. And you could say that it's actually learning through art that you can acquire some of these skills. So it's actually balancing between these different notions of citizenship. So I will in this presentation, I will present some of the objectives of the project. I will present the learning program, the workshops. I will present an employment program that was also part of the project. And I will end by showing you a small film that was made as part of the project. I won't go into details with all of the objectives, but some of the main objectives was to create close collaborations with language schools. We often experience that language schools actually use us a lot. They are coming in, they are using the collections. They often book tours, and especially in the Department of Old Danish Art, Golden Age Painting, and they use us to gain insight to or to have an introduction to Danish culture, history, art history, because it's also part of the curriculum of the Danish language schools. But we wanted to do something else, so we wanted to kind of move the way or kind of push the way the language schools are using us to instead look into how can we actually, through the personal experience of the artworks, can we actually also make space for acquiring a new language. So we wanted to make this shift from being in the art museum to get knowledge about Danish society to actually learn something through the art about, also maybe about yourself, but that's one part of it. Yeah, and then of course in this it's also important to say that it's of course in a dual or in a double learning process. So it's not only about the language learners, it's also about the museum learning something about ourselves and getting these kind of new narratives instead of only the old master narratives or authoritative narratives. Yes, so just have to keep track. So just to point out, of course, this is a really diverse target group, a really diverse group of users, because, I mean, they are not defined by gender or the same nationality. They are defined by the fact that they are in Denmark for the time being, or they are in Denmark in right now also in the process of learning Danish. So that's actually what is defining this group. And they are, of course, they have come to Denmark for so many different reasons. Some are there because they can no longer live in their native country, some because they have got a work, some because they've got married. So, I mean, it's a really, really diverse group. So you just have to be aware of that when I'm talking about the target group. So this was a little bit about some of the objectives of the project. And now I will try to first tell you something about the very specific learning program or the workshops we developed before moving into the employment program. And present what we actually did. So it maybe seems a little bit banal, but I thought it would be really nice to you to get a feeling of the workshop structure. So first of all, when we work with education programs at the SMK, the National Gallery, we always work with dialogue-based teaching. And I won't go into detail with that, but just say that some of the key words when we work with dialogue-based teaching is participation and variation and multi-voicedness. So, of course, multi-voicedness is also part at the core of the whole project. So, when we started developing the project, we invited a lot of different groups of language learners, and we invited the Danish contemporary artist Lise Harlev to collaborate with us on developing the learning program or the workshop. And we invited her specifically because, first of all, well, she's presented it in our collections. But first of all, because she's actually dealing herself in her artistic practice with the whole situation of moving to another country, of learning a new language, and what it actually means for your social relations, and also for your social skills. So in this way, it was obvious to invite her. So we did a lot of trial runs and evaluations, and one of the things that Lise really was keen on telling us was that she insisted on in the process was how we could show the participants the joy of using words. So she really insisted on the playfulness and make space for joy and humor in learning a new language. So we actually ended up doing a very simple workshop focusing on words, single words, not syntax and grammar, single words, and on the personal experience of the words and on the personal experience of art. So just to sum up a little bit some of Lise's, what she said about her point of view. So it was important to feel that you can impress yourself in the new language, that you don't have to be afraid of it. And in that spirit, the workshop focuses on the participants' personal experience of the art, not on the art historical presentation of them. Language is one way of expressing something personal, and in the same way, the art in a museum is full of personal emotions, beliefs, and stories. It was important for me to accentuate the validity of the personal approach and to show the participants that the language, the museum, and the art is theirs too. So we developed two very simple, actually quite simple assignments. The first one was called My Favorite Danish Word and My New Favorite Danish Word. And we actually started up having a cup of coffee, tea, a cake. And then we started with this very simple work assignment where everybody in the room, also the art educators, the language teachers, they had to write down their favorite Danish word. And it could be because it had a nice sound, it looked nice, it was weird, it had a specific signification. So it could be a lot of different reasons. And we put the stickers on the clothes. And then at the end of the day, we had more stickers on the clothes because we had to choose new favorite Danish words. And what actually happened was that this made some really kind of surprising, funny situations when walking around in the museum as some kind of walking dictionaries and going, you could say, into combination with each other, but also with the artworks, making crazy interpretations of the artworks. So this was kind of the first small assignment, and then we did another one. Again, this is very simple, and So these are just from the pilot projects where we just did these very simple sheets. So the idea was to go around into the museum working with, so each group of students were working with one piece of art, and we had a lot of different artworks we worked with, and they got these very simple sentences saying, for instance, the painting makes me feel. Then the other student in the group got another sentence saying, but the painting also makes me feel, and then the last one in the group got a sentence saying, but the painting doesn't make me feel. And when everybody had worked individually with the artworks, we gathered together, and then we actually did this kind of performance or performative presentation of their thoughts and their experiences, their perception of the artworks. So it actually came to be this kind of very funny situation where maybe one of them had said, the painting makes me feel sad, the next one, but the painting also makes me feel angry, and the last one, but the painting doesn't make me feel sad. So we never knew what would come up, so it would create these surprising situations. So it really kind of brought us places where we wouldn't know where we would actually end up, and of course we had a lot of discussion about the experiences of the artworks or why they actually chose these specific words. So you could say that the both assignment was really about this constant focus on the personal experience of both language and art, and about also kind of grasping the surprising situations of what was going on when we walked around with the stickers. So in one way it was we chose the artworks, but on the other hand it was completely unpredicted what would happen when we worked with the artworks. So we really tried to make space for the surprising and the unpredictable. So this was very short about this workshop, and maybe I should just say that of course we gathered all the words all day, so it was also the idea, and here it's all again about these two maybe different notions of citizenship, because on the one hand they also came to actually learn Danish words, they actually came to also acquire and broaden their language, but doing it through working with the art. So now I will present the employment program, because part of the project was also So part of the project was also to try out in a very small scale an employment program. So we employed three language students at the SMK and four language students at the Thorvaldsen Museum. And at the SMK we had Maya from Latvia and Lizelle from the Philippines and Wahid from Iran. And in collaboration with them we developed some three small educational films that was to be used as a resource, a learning resource for language learners and language schools. So we, the reason we employed or we wanted to try out this employment program was of course to collaborate with the target group in developing the whole teaching or learning resources. And again, of course, it's a very diverse group. And then also because we wanted to make space for these other narratives about the artworks in the museum, to make space for alternative narratives in the museum. But we also wanted to make space for the language learners to actually learn Danish in an everyday environment at a working place and also gain insight into a Danish workplace culture. So again, it actually had these very different goals. So all the students that had attended the workshops, they could apply. And we got actually a lot of application. I think we got 30 in all. And we had to choose, of course, three of them. So we tried to take account to gender, language, age, etc., to make kind of a broad representation. And what they were going to do was they were going to work with us in developing these small films, educational films. So they were going to have their everyday, well, not their everyday, because the hours were spread all over the week, so they could still attend school. But they were at the museum at about 2.5 months. So it's, as I said, it's a really small scale experiment, a pilot project. And they were working with us developing these films. So we... We made a program for them, of course, to they could get an introduction to the museum, but also so they could slowly start working, getting used to this new environment, getting a feeling of security in this new environment, getting to know their new colleagues. And then they started working with exploring the the collections and choosing their artwork. And they did this both together, the three of them, together with us, the art educators. But then they also they wrote down a lot of their words. They had a lot of different kind methods to kind of pull. Gather all their words together about these artworks. And then they also started interviewing curators, conservators, whoever they wanted to interview in the museum, but also guests at the museum. And they invited friends and families to the museum as well to discuss the artworks. And then they wrote the film manuscript, and we recorded the film with the SMK film crew. And I think I will just show you one of the films now. They are all on our website, but I think it would be nice of you to see it. Well, actually, this is just a slide. We had a film premiere where Vahid did the welcoming speech. And
Hej, jeg hedder Vahid og kommer fra Iran. Jeg kom til Danmark for næsten 9 måneder siden og begyndte at lære dansk på Kommunalens Sprogskole med det samme. Jeg er tandlæge, og jeg er også international berolning damer. Og nu samarbejder jeg med State Museum for Kunst i et projekt, som handler om dansk undervisning. Og her er vores kontor på museet. به نظر من این خیلی جالب میتونه باشه که آدم زبان جدیدی رو در محیطی غیر از مدرسه اون هم به صورت درست یاد بگیره. خصوصا اگر اینکه این آموزش همراه با آشنایی با فرهنگ و هنر اون جامعه باشه. که در واقع یک تیر هست با دو نشان. از یک طرف با فرهنگ و هنر اون جامعه آشنا بشی، از یک طرف زبانشون رو یاد بگیری. و میشه اینطور گفت که اینها لازمه های جدایی ناپذیر حل شدن این نفر در جامعه جدید هستن. من به شخص خیلی خوشحالم که شانس شرکت در این پروژه رو داشتم. فکر میکنم که چیزای خوبی یاد گرفتم اینجا و میتونم اینطور بگم که الان احساس خیلی بهتری نسبت به دانمارک دارم. In her Das Jahr für Kunst, Foto für Kunst, sammeln Seltsinnen. Nach Kunstwerk für ihn, Tiatenke, ein Wirtleben für ihr sammeln Racket, so ruft er ihn für den reellen Werden, die den ideellen Werden, hat Kunstwerk ab 9. Mord, sammeln Elohim Soja. For eksempel, når jeg betrækter det statue for at sælge 100-tallet, kommer jeg til at tænke på kampen mellem to atleter. Jeg tænker på historie, på mit land, og på Kyrus den store, som var den første kong af Persien. Jeg tænker på alle de store helte, der igennem historien har kæmpet for filantropi og retfærdighed. Når alt det er sagt, mener statuen mig mis om den historiske sportsgrand berulning, og dens betydning som en grund til at berulning altid har været en del af olympiaden, og et argument for at de i fremtiden også skal få blivet i det. Et andet bemærkelsesværdigt punkt i dette skulptur, som har fanget min opmærksomhed, er at jeg som en tandlæge forstår det sådan, at denne kunstner, som har levet dette kunstværk, ikke kun har været bevist om kroppens anatomi, men ligeledes har haft et godt kendskab til tændernes anatomi. Jeg er helt forbløffet over, at de to figures tænder er levet på en så naturlig måde. Sazende ناشناس این اثر من رو به یاد قهرمانان بزرگی انداخت که یک روزی در این دنیا مثل خودش زندگی کردند ولی ما اونها رو متاسفانه نمیشناسیم، در حالی که زندگی هر کدوم از اونها میتونه سوژه یک فیلم بسیار زیبا همچون گلادیاتور باشه. همچنین من رو به یاد شعر شاعر بزرگ ایرانی خیام انداخت که میگه ای دوست بیا تا غم فردا نخوریم، وین یکدم عمر را غنیمت شماریم. فردا که از این دیر فنا درگذریم، با 7000 سالگان سر به سریم. بدرود.
this. So this was Wahid from Iran, and just the seven films are very, very different. The frame was the same. They had to introduce themselves. They had to say something in mother tongue and in Danish. They had to present the artwork, and they had to present a place where their favorite place. And it was actually my desk in the beginning, and I just realized that there was this Danish flag. It almost seemed very funny to see that, and I haven't noticed it before because it had been my birthday, I think. So, well, actually, as I said, the seven films are really different. Lizelle, she is a trained nurse, and she chose an artwork where she, an installation with a hospital, where she starts to diagnose the people in the hospital coming into the room. Maya chose something about golden Danish art painting. So they are really, really different. And I think the film shows these different kind of citizenship notions. And I will end by a quote by Lizelle. That also, I think, reflects very well these different kind of objectives of the project, where she's saying that working here at the SMK is good for me. It makes me creative. The art helps me think and see the world. And I've never learned so many words in such a brief time before. And yes, I speak Danish all day, etc. So she points out both the fact that she is learning this language, she is learning something about also a Danish workplace culture, but it also makes space for the creative and this kind of free interpretation. So this was the first case presentation. So here you are, Lisa. Yeah,
thanks. And I represent a second case, and it differs in many ways from the one Nana just presented. And now. No. Okay, thank you. Most of all, because this is my case is not planned. It's not a program I'm looking at. I'm doing a PhD, so I'm doing some participant observations. So this is a situation that appears when I'm there. So I'm looking at what appears in a daily life, and that's one of the things we want you to look, go into in the workshop as well. And then I'm not focusing on what the pupils learn or what they need to learn. And I quote Piesta saying the focus should not be on telling citizens what they need to learn to become better citizens, but should lie with keeping open those places and spaces where the experiment of democracy can be conducted. And I think, and he's not talking about art museums at all, but I think this understanding of citizenship and democracy maybe could give another perspective to the art institutions in general. So that's what I'm trying to. And then I'm looking for disruptions. I'm looking for where is there something happening? Where is there something changing? And it's based on another way of understanding democracy than our common knowledge. And what we are referring to very often also in this conference is a democracy or representation as representation. If the artworks represent the audience, or if the audience coming into the art institutions represent the whole society. And the way of understanding democracy I'm trying to hear is different. It's based on Chagondhia and Gebjesta, and it's understanding democracy as sporadic, as something which appears sometimes. And the reason why they have this understanding of democracy is because they don't understand democracy as a stable order. Because if you understand democracy as a stable order, we just have to fit into this order. But we have to change all the time our understanding of democracy. And all the time in relation to notions of equality. So I will try to explain this understanding with these pictures of the sheep. And it's the front page of one of Gebjesta's books. And the way he described democracy is, it's something that appears in the moment where one sheep is turning around and demand for another way of thinking, another way of being. Another way of thinking or another way of being which connect to equality, because the order can never be equal. We can never get an equal society. And when this disturbance happened, it may give the possibility for both a new way of being a sheep and a new way of understanding the order, the society. And this is the way he talks about democracy. And that's why I'm looking at this moment that appear in the cases. And I will give an example of one of these disruptions, which might lead to democratic potential. So I will present a case, and it's a case from Aachen Museum, and I'm here doing some observation with a school group, and they're 11 years old, and we have been looking around the museum, and now we have to look at this artwork by Elena Proteus. And I will tell you what happened while we were looking at the artwork, but I will turn it on so you can see the artwork. It's a video art without sound, so I will speak while you're seeing it. So now you have to imagine that you are together with a group of 11 years old and a teacher and a museum educator sitting down on the floor in a museum looking at this artwork. And then I will try to explain you what happened.
It doesn't really work. Here it is. It's very slow.
Nothing happened. Uh-oh. Can we get some help?
Tilbage her.
Og der er så link til YouTube. Sorry.
Den er helt død.
Linket er der jo.
Den virkede i... Okay, den der kan næsten ikke mere.
Okay, so now you're sitting at the museum, looking at this, and it's a very small screen, and you're sitting on the floor with this group of 11 years old. And the museum educator tell you to just look at this artwork for a moment. And then after a while, one of the boys raised the questions. But what are we supposed to look for? And no one reacts. Neither the kids or the teachers. And after a while, he asks again, a little bit louder. But what are we supposed to look for? And there's no sound in this artwork. There's no sound in the museum. So of course, everyone can hear his question. But no one answers. And I start to think, this is really strange. Because I think he raised a very good question in an art museum, a very relevant question. And I think it points to the dilemma between the two different ways of understanding art, either explaining what to look for or saying that it's up to you what you see. And I think it actually shows some of the problematics what we are doing. And I also think that it actually is a question about if all ways of looking are as good. And then I also think that it also tells some things about what the image do. Maybe it's just reflecting what it see. So maybe this question have to do with the artwork and not because of something inside of himself. And then he raised the question again. But what are we supposed to look for? But no one answer, and they keep on looking at this artwork, and afterwards the teacher talk about the artwork in general. And then when it's finished, the teacher come to me, the teacher from the school, and say, sorry, he have Asperger's syndrome. So maybe you need to help me to come back to the, yeah. And of course, this is a disturbance in many ways. Both the question, the quietness, and the excuse, and the information about that he have Asperger's syndrome. And I'm trying to look into this case, seeing what is happening. And actually, I think that he raised a question which had a potential for changing things, changing ways of understanding. But I also see it as it actually prevented a democratic potential. And it did that by having predefined understandings of what art is, what audience is, kids is, Asperger syndrome, for example, teaching, a learning program is, and also about the role of the art museum. So it actually gives the information to re-ask or questioning what are art museums and what are art supposed to do and what do we want with it. So it has, in this way, it can re-question our understanding of art and museums. And that's what I'm going to try to do now. I just need that. Yeah. So see this as a small experiment? It's something I'm working on right now. So it's not a kind of conclusion at all. It's a thought experiment, which I thought could be interesting for you to go on with in the workshop. So I see this as a way that enabled me to see not what art is, not focusing on what art is, but on what art do. And in that way, we come back to the powerful thing about the artwork we just heard about this morning. Because if you focus on what art does, then it's not on the master narratives, because the master narratives are connected to what art is. And it's not about understanding art as representing a group. If we only see Danish art, it's for Danish people, or if we see Norwegian art, it's for Norwegian. But we actually look at what art does instead. And if we look at what art does, then we also have to change our way of understanding learning. Then we don't need to learn about art, but we need to learn through art. And then I think actually we have the possibility to take our point of departure in equality. Because if it's what learning through art, it's not to get to some fixed results. And then the master narratives are not the primary narratives. But if we learn about art, it's based on inequality, and it's based on this understanding of we have to learn the pupils how to look before they become real citizens. So in making this kind of shift, it may be possible to take our point of departure on inequality and stop thinking in us and them. So let's try that, and that will be the background for the discussions this afternoon.
Yes, so the idea now is actually that we will do some kind of very big roundtable session. So we have made some questions you can discuss at each table, and the questions will be here on the screen during the whole session. So we actually want to reflect upon your own practice. And we know that your practices are really, it's so many different institutions you come from. But we would like you to discuss these questions. How do you relate your own practice to citizenship, disciplinary citizenship, qualification and socialization, cultural citizenship, new becomings identity, and how these, of course, are mixed and interweaved? And also to try to think of situations where you have experienced disruptions in your work with the audience engagement, and kind of looking back at these disruptions these kind of unpredicted situations, did you, kind of looking back now, can you see some kind of democratic potentials? So it's of course very, very big questions, but we really want you to relate them to your own practice. And the idea is that Nana, who is sitting down here, Nana Holger, and Bjarki, who is sitting over here, and Lisa and I, we will also be walking around, and you can ask us more questions, and yeah, and we can have a discussion, and then I think that will be the program of the workshop here after our presentation. So thank you very much, and we will come around discussing it with you. Thank you.